Welcome to another season of the Future Report podcast. Now, if you're a faithful listener that's been listening for many seasons, or if you're a bit newer, I'm sure that you are aware, based on some of our previous topics, that you know that at McCrindle we love to talk about people in generations. Every time we conduct a study, it's pretty much the first place we go to see differences in response, and we absolutely 100% believe in it. But recently, I've been considering the downside of categorising people into generations. Maybe downside's a bit too intense of a term, but just the pros and the cons. What are the things that we need to be aware of, maybe rather, as we think about people in generations? So I wanted to get Sophie Renton's insights on this today because she is the Managing Director at McCrindle. She loves talking about people in generations. We talk about this off camera, so I thought let's bring it on camera, on mic today, to talk about the pros and cons of discussing people in generations. So hello, Sophie Renton. Welcome back to the podcast.
Hello, Ashley Fell. Delighted to be here.
So I pretty much told everyone that you are a big generational expert fan, but I won't put words in your mouth. Sophie, I'm keen to know, or keen for you to share with me and the listeners, whether you've always been a fan of speaking about people in generations, or is it something that has more so started since you kind of began working at McCrindle?
Yeah, I've always really enjoyed it, I guess, observing people at different life stages, learning from those that have gone before, seeing the characteristics, the habits of people in, I guess, different ages. Studying sociology at uni was one of my favorite things to do. I probably just didn't really put the term generational analysis around it as clearly as I did until I started working at McCrindle. So yeah, I think I've always loved watching people and watching even, you know, mothers and daughters out at a cafe and looking at their similarities, looking at their differences. So I think it's been in there, but it's been working here that's really, I guess, honed the craft.
Yeah, I would say the same. I think it's something inherent in those of us who are curious about people and groups, and if you had an interest in society and culture and those kind of ways of looking at human behavior in groups, what influences people. So yeah, I definitely agree as well. And I think for me, it was definitely just heightened when we started working here, when I started working here, because the generational analysis is such a big part of what we do. We are credited with naming one of the generations, Mark named Generation Alpha. So it's such a big part of our work and our expertise. And I guess, as I prefaced a moment ago, you know, we go out, you and I, and we speak at a lot of conferences and we talk to people. And I guess there are often, like any good talk, it raises questions for people and it sparks ideas and, you know, challenges people's way of thinking. And I think in recent times, I've been engaging with more, I guess, critical conversations with people about whether generational analysis is helpful. And I remember actually when we were writing the Generation Alpha book, we put like in one of the first chapters, I guess, like a devil's advocate question that we wanted to address is kind of, is generational analysis stereotyping? Like, is it fair to say that Gen Y, because they were born at this time and impacted by these circumstances, have these characteristics? Because I think what I found, even as someone who belongs to that generation, when I see the research, there are some things where I'm like, oh yeah, I fit into the majority of Gen Y on this stance, but then other ways where I'm like, oh no, maybe I'm exhibiting baby boomer characteristics, or, you know, like, it's interesting, I guess, to think about the pros and the cons, the benefits and some of the downsides to be when it comes to generational analysis. So I wanted to unpack that with you today, Soph. So keen to hear, I guess, how you think generational labels like, of course, the baby boomers, Gen X, millennials, Gen Z, shape our understanding of social and cultural dynamics, and whether you feel comfortable sharing, I guess, an example of how these labels have influenced perceptions and behaviours within different age groups.
Yeah, I do believe that they shape our understanding of social and cultural dynamics, and we look at characteristics of a different generation and we can pigeonhole them into that, like our baby boomers, typically more hardworking, conservative, wise. And then we're going to unpack this further, but how much of that is life stage and how much of that is actually their generation. But those are some of the, I guess, labels and characteristics that we put around people. And I think if I think of an example that's been I guess, relevant to my own life around this. I, as a millennial or a Gen Y, I think we've had to fight a lot of stereotypes when it's come to the workforce, of being lazy, of being entitled. And in some ways, thanks Gen Z, when you came into the workforce, you started to make us look pretty good around our work ethic. But we love you, Gen Z. But I think what Gen Y did, and it's what every generation that's always done as they've come through, is that they've challenged the rules of the game. They've challenged the social norms. They've brought a new perspective, a new paradigm. And really, they've challenged the status quo. And that can be really unnerving for some people who have built their security or their understanding of the world based on these paradigms. So I think when we think about our understanding of social and cultural dynamics, we need to understand that people born at different times have different experiences. They're shaped in different education systems. They're shaped in different cultures and different times and societies. And that influences how they approach situations, how they behave in certain situations based on what has been the cultural norm of the time. So there are elements of generational analysis that I think stand true the test of time around based on how they've been shaped. But I think there are some that are influenced by life stage. And so there are definitely benefits, but there's also inherent challenges and biases that do come with generational analysis.
Yeah. And I mean, your reflection there about the workforce, I think, is a really great example and a space that we see a lot of commentary, whether it's in the media or even commentary that we put out. We want to be research-based and evidence-based, and we are. And I often feel like we're generational defendants. Like, there'll be a Gen Z just need praise, and it'll be like a clickbaity title of an article, and then we'll come in and be like, well, the research is showing X, Y, Z, and what we need to keep in mind is, you know, this and that. And I guess for us, you know, our Generations Defined report that we released last year, we looked at generations as employees and as consumers, and it was really interesting to see, especially in the area where we were talking about what attracts each generation to a place of employment, how different the different generations were in their responses. I'm pretty sure we've already covered this on the podcast, but for those who can't remember, I guess what we looked at was how important are a bunch of different areas when considering a new job. And when we filtered that by generation, it was interesting to see Gen Z were, I guess, more focusing on growth and learning, working with leaders who invest in their learning and development. Whereas for Gen Y, who were kind of in their 30s and 40s, it was about flexibility and location. For Generation X, remuneration topped the list, followed by accessible leaders. And for the baby boomers, who are a bit older at the latter end of their working years, it was about convenient location and remuneration. And the reason I brought this up is because I shared about this on LinkedIn, and it was interesting because I guess in light of all the conversations I had been having recently, I put in this post, it's important to understand, you know, people of different generations and what they're looking for. And I had the table of all the different generations and what they want in a new place of employment. But then I put in there as well that there are some caveats for leaders to remember. And one, the first one I said was that people don't always fit into generational majorities, and knowing your unique team members and their own motivations is key. And I feel like that was the part of the post that a lot of people appreciated, because they're like, well, the research is there and that's important, but also remember, if you're a leader or someone who is leading people, don't just think, oh, well, the survey showed that Gen Y want this, so therefore all the Gen Ys in my workforce want this. Like, it's about knowing your own people, and sometimes people don't fit into those majorities of each generation. So yeah, it's interesting, I think, especially when it comes to the workforce, like you mentioned, and the stereotypes that come with each generation, they can be helpful ways of understanding a particular generation's perspective, but we also need to keep that in mind. And again, even when I think about that post, just as an example, and I guess I think it was Mark once who said, it's almost like the comment section of an article is interesting for a social researcher, because people start debating ideas and seeing what resonates. And I think a lot of people were saying, and this is feedback I get all the time about our research with regards to generations, is that these, I guess, provide a starting point or a helpful kind of launch pad for understanding different generations in whatever context. So would you see that as being, I guess, one of the key benefits in your perspective of generational analysis in understanding social behaviour, trends and patterns in society?
Yeah, it starts a conversation to bring a level of understanding. And I think if we put it as a finite box, it actually limits what it's trying to do, because it can never, through a series of questions, define a person in its entirety at all. And there are always moments when you have different responses or different feelings, when you are like the crowd, when you're different from the crowd. So it's a starting point to begin a conversation to, I guess, shape the future. So if you take the workforce, for example, that's one that I do love talking about, as we think about the people. And as a leader, honestly, some days it's overwhelming when you look at the challenge before you to go, we're trying to achieve this goal. I have this team of people and there is a massive chasm in between. How on earth am I going to navigate that? And the first part comes back to understanding your team, understanding what motivates them, understanding what inspires them, understanding how you can align them and then empower them to achieve that vision. Now, having the research that we've done around, you know, what are some of the attractors to the job, or what are some of the key motivators, or what are some of the key things that will keep people retained, gives you a starting point. Because, you know, if you have to dream with no boundaries, that paralyzes people. Whereas if you can have a framework or a scope or a frame of reference to begin, then you can take that to your team and go, okay, so does this actually resonate with you? Is it, where do you align? Where do you differ from this? How can we, I guess, shift that conversation forward? So I think that's probably one of the real benefits of the generational analysis, is that it gives us a lens to be able to follow a group over time and see what are the characteristics that, I guess, stay consistent. It's so important as leaders, as organizations, to be able to then tailor our communications, our offerings, or our engagement in such a way that will actually speak to the unique needs and desires of that generation. And in a time when there's so much personalization, when there's expectation inflation, when, my goodness, we're so rushed and we just need to slow down our lives, you want to be able to know you're going to hit the mark first time, or at least second time. So having, I guess, a framework which can allow you to narrow in a little bit more, so you're not just fighting in the dark, is really powerful. And I think that's what generation analysis can do. And it's, I think it's in some ways it's a little bit more accurate for our older generations, because we've been able to track them for a longer period of time. Also, as you get older, you're more set in your ways, is a horrible way to say it, but you're more consistent in your approach to life, maybe. And you can predict a little bit more how someone might respond in a certain situation. And then as you get younger, people are more flexible, they are more adaptable, and they are more open to the introduction of new ideas. But if we look at that younger generation and say, well, what do they value now? What do they believe in? What motivates them? What have been the key topics of conversation in their formative years? Because that's largely going to influence what they're going to take into the future. It actually gives us a window into what the future could look like. It's definitely not a 100% prediction that this is what it's going to be, but it allows leaders to look just that next step further. So I think it's really powerful for understanding your team members, engaging in such a way that speaks to their desires and speaks to their needs. And it also gives us a lens into the future so that we can start to position our organizations well for what could be on the horizon.
Yeah, I think it's really helpful to give some, of course, some data-led insights rather than just stereotypes that we hear about in the media, which is, I guess, the role that we see us playing in this space. I think the other thing that it does as well, which you highlighted there, is that it enables you to, I guess, approach people who are of a different age to you, who grew up in a different time, with a bit more empathy, if you can appreciate that they weren't raised in the same context that you're being raised right now. And I think about it, I guess, in terms of hearing younger people, hearing my friends talk about older generations as, say, being intolerant or not caring about the environment or whatever it might be with regards to a range of different topical issues at the moment, important issues. And I'm not saying that just because they weren't raised in a time where it was an important issue doesn't mean that they should get a free pass about being ignorant or whatever it might be. But I think when we look at, and we did this again in our generation study, even just the type of content or the messaging that each generation kind of received through the books and entertainment and news when they were growing up, you see some really big differences across the generations. And I guess for me, I have a level of empathy and understanding when I look at that and say, oh, older generations weren't being educated about looking after the environment as much as we are today, or they weren't educated about XYZ issue. And so I think we can understand that. And the same way goes for the other, I guess, reciprocated, where older generations can look at younger generations and go, oh, okay, this is what the conversation is. This is what the issues are at the moment. It makes sense then that they have these values, or these were the technologies that shaped them. And so it makes sense as to why they behave this way. So I think even just that starting point of understanding and empathy, that's helpful. And again, part of that is a big part of it is understanding the context that shapes a group of people, from the technologies to the events that happen in their formative years. Even, I think I'm sure we've talked about this on the podcast, but older generations and their money habits and why they exhibit a particular level of, say, being frugal. And when you understand that they grew up in times of war or depression, you're like, well, of course they would still have those habits. So it's interesting to navigate all those things. But I think empathy is such a big part of generational analysis. Would you agree, Sophie?
It's huge. Yeah, empathy is massive. And I think the more that we can actually have empathy for the different generations, the more we can actually have a cohesive society. If we constantly look at the differences without understanding where they might come from, that can create real friction and can create real issues. And I actually remember in a university class asking or posing a question to my peers around a particular topic, and you know, everyone was getting on their high horse and just being like, oh, it's so awful what they did. Like, can't believe that in this context people would do such a thing. And I just remember pausing and asking a bit one of those like devil's advocate questions. And I was like, okay, just pause. If you were shaped in the same environment that they were, with the same social acceptance that was okay, do you actually think you would have done anything different? I think that's a really sobering question for us to even ask ourselves, to go, okay, if I was born in that time, in that environment, if these were the social and cultural norms of the time that have shaped my perspective and my behavior, would I have done anything different? And I think more often than not, the answer is probably no, because we are shaped by what is around us. And I think when you can actually recognize not your own failings, but your own just ability to be shaped. Like, none of us want to recognize that we're shaped by what's around us and influenced, but we are.
You're right.
And so if we can actually recognize that and recognize our own humanity and our own failings and our own flaws, it actually positions us in a much better place to actually have a conversation and acknowledge the differences, but have the empathy to actually move forward despite them.
Yeah. And I see a lot of people commenting on something as trivial as, you know, TV shows and what they said back in the 90s, that is, when you put your 2024 lens on it, you're like, gosh, that would never fly today, or that was so rude, or whatever it is. But like, you're right, when we go, well, let's think about the time in which that content was produced and that sort of thing. And even like you said there, when you hear stories of particularly older generations who went through times that we might, again, lay judgment on for their action or inaction, it's different, I think, when, and this is the power of stories, when you hear it recounted from someone and you hear about what they learned or what they didn't, or they go, well, we didn't know these things at the time. And then it gives you, again, you go, oh, okay, rather, you have that empathy and the understanding rather than judging someone for how they behaved in a different context. So just the importance of context, I think, is key, and the importance of stories and listening to other people is really important in our world today. So definitely some key benefits, of course. We have done seasons of episodes about the benefits, but I guess I also wanted to again play a bit of devil's advocate and think about, what are the limitations or the risks of, say, over relying on generational analysis or stereotypes when examining complex issues, whether it's societal or in the workplace or within our families. So if, do you have any reflections on the potential limitations that over-relying on this helpful way of analysis can pose for us?
Yeah, the first is that it really can put people in a box, and it can make people feel like they can't be unique, or they can't be different, or that the leadership will only view them a certain way because, well, that's the generation that they are. And I think if we do that, we actually limit the beauty of humanity, and that's actually never what we're trying to do. Generational analysis should never be used to define someone. It should only ever be used to help somebody. And I think if generational analysis is being used to define, despite us using the phrase defining the generations in our report title, then I think it's kind of gone haywire. But as we said before, it's to start a conversation, is to give a launch pad into an open conversation to be able to guide the way forward. And I think one of the things that we've got to be really careful about with generational analysis, and it's something I even find the tension of in writing some of our reports, is that generational analysis can really overvalue our differences and undervalue our similarities. So what I mean by that is that in our reports, so often I am inclined to write about, and I do write about, and I need to even get better at this again, is that you draw out the stats where there's a massive generational difference, that you go, okay, well, look, the younger generation, Gen Z, they say it's 70% or whatever, say that they are extremely or very passionate about protecting the environment. I'm making this stat up just for clarification. Compared to, the sentiment is actually based on a true one, but I can't remember the exact numbers. Compared to maybe the baby boomers, where, you know, 20% might do that. And so then you've got that it's like, oh, it's like nearly three times more likely to do this. And, you know, those are the ones that people find interesting, and they're the ones that you kind of grab a hold of. But to the same extent, we need to actually maybe take something like kindness and go, oh, there was actually no, like 70% of Australians might value kindness. And then adding in that line, there's no distinct difference between the generations. Like, all generations actually see this as important. And that's something that I need to even get better at doing, because I'm like, oh, it's not a difference. It's not interesting. But actually, it's really powerful that it is the same, and that I think with generational analysis we can overvalue those differences and go, oh, this is where we're different, but actually, well, where are the points that we are similar, because those are just as powerful for leaders and organizations to understand, so that we can create that cohesive society that we're all looking for. We need to acknowledge both our similarities and our differences, and I think that can go a really long way for dispelling or de-escalating some of the generational division that can happen, because we need to recognize that we're actually more similar than we are different. There's so much of humanity that unites us. We might express things in different ways, but core values, honestly, so much of that is held so similarly across the generations. And I think the other thing that we need to be aware of with generational analysis, and it's similar to the putting people in a box, but we need to recognize that there are the cuspers who sit on the edge of a generation, and you're much closer to a cusper, probably are a cusper, than I am. I'm like pretty much dead set in my generation. So sadly, the stereotypes fit me quite well. But, you know, there are some parts of Gen Z that you really align with, and some parts of Gen Y that you really align with. And we need to make sure that we create the space and opportunity for people to actually reflect that in their lives. So if we're using generational analysis to put people in a box, we've really missed the point. We should use it to inform leaders and organizations to actually be able to serve the people that have been entrusted to them better.
Yeah, that's so wise. So many great phrases and insights in that answer, Soph. And I think we are similar. We're a similar generation, like you said, but also similar people. And we work in organization. We work in the same organization we have for a long time, which is amazing. But it's interesting because what you were saying was also, I guess, reminiscent of how I tried to frame the end of the generations report, like in light of, like you mentioned, like that generations defined title and the whole report being basically just a what we call crosstab of all the questions we asked. It was just, what are the differences by generation? Let's talk about those differences. At the end, I was like, but don't forget what unites us, you know, like just like a little tiny, like, don't forget this huge thing that, like, again. And it was interesting because the three kind of takeaways that I put at the end of that report were: understand how people are different by generation, look for what unites us, and you mentioned that, like, those core human needs, like whether you're a millennial or a Gen Z or a Gen Alpha or a baby boomer, like everyone wants to work in a workplace where they feel safe and where they belong, and that doesn't change. And like you said, like the kindness example is a really good one, because I think we often go to the differences because they're most interesting and give us really helpful insights. Like it would be pretty boring if we were like every generation thinks this and every generation is aligned on everything, you know, like it would, we have nuance and we have differences, which is important to acknowledge, but also to remember what unites us. And if anything, that's probably more important towards unification of your community or your team or your sports team or whatever, when you've got people of different ages working together who do exhibit differences in behavior or values, what's that common purpose that you're coming together for, and how do you align people to that when they are different, of different ages? So really important, really powerful. And I guess that leads me to the next question, which is a huge tension that I try and obviously be very eloquent at talking about, but I do find it an interesting question. And someone asked me this very recently in a presentation where we were talking about, you know, different generations and the research that we had conducted about what they value. And someone said, well, is this characteristic of the fact that Gen Z are in their 20s, or is it because they're Gen Z? Like, is it a life stage thing that because they're starting out in their career, they want career advice and they're prioritizing learning and development? Like, did the baby boomers when they were at Gen Z's age now value the same things? Like, what's characteristic of your life stage compared to what's characteristic of the generation you belong in? So, Soph, not to give us the... is it one or the other? It's both and, I have no doubt. But what are your reflections on that? Do you find that being something that you're thinking about as well when you're talking about characteristics of a generation? Are you thinking, is this life stage, or is this something that they'll kind of carry through even as they move out of that life stage?
Yeah, it's so important to have both of those in tension, that it is generation and it is life stage. If we solely focus on generation, then we miss out the elements of life stage. If we solely focus on life stage, then we miss out on the elements of generation and context that has shaped people. So it's never one or the other, but it is both. And I was thinking of what are some of examples of this? And I was thinking of, you know, the baby boomers. They grew up in a time when culture was hard work, consistency, community. And those are values that they've really carried throughout their life around building society. Like, if we look at so many of the companies that have made such an impact in our world, so many of those have been led by baby boomers. And then even... and Gen X as well has, but then Gen X, the latchkey kids, the, you know, the kids that are going home to that empty home after school because they've got two parents working for the first time, society altogether shifted much more than really it had in a long time. And this generation, they really learned independence at an early age. They've been the generation that has always said nothing defines them. Even the label Generation X was supposed to do exactly that. And so they've carried some of those characteristics through their life in the way that they lead. They're entrepreneurs, they want to do things different, they don't want to just recreate what had gone before them. Now, we can understand that characteristic of the generation, but if we only look at Gen X with that, without actually understanding, well, what's their current life stage? And Gen X, their current life stage is that they're the sandwich generation. They're carrying both up and down, and that the time and the emotional and financial pressure that that puts on them is huge. So if we're leading a Gen X person and only take in maybe their, it's actually probably more likely that they're leading us, but if we look at them and go, okay, well, you know, independent, entrepreneurial, not willing to be defined by anything, but willing to put their stamp on the ground, and go, okay, that's everything that they're about, without taking in their current life stage and going, goodness, we need to have so much empathy for what they're trying to navigate and what they're trying to hold right now. Do they actually even have any time for themselves? Like, how are they doing in amongst trying to be all things to all people around them? And I think it is always the tension of both, and we need to make sure that we are looking through it, the lens of both of those. And so I think you can never remove one from the other. But when you have both of them in tandem, you can actually see the fullest picture.
Yeah. And I was thinking as well what you said earlier in the episode about it's easy with the baby boomers, for example, because they have lived a lot of life, and we can look back and go, what happened in their formative years that kind of we can draw a correlation between their values and behavior now, 30, 40 years on from their formative years. Whereas I guess for generations who are in their formative years, it's like, well, we can make predictions and we often do about their values and what we think they will carry beyond the life stage they're in into the next life stage. But yeah, it's interesting to kind of look at all these different areas of life and society and work and culture and community where different generations interact with each other, and think about, yeah, what's characteristic of them and their context versus what's been similar things that previous generations in the same life stage have held to be true or important. So definitely, I think having both in there, remembering both, acknowledging both, is a wise way to think about it. As we think about, I guess, the future and generational analysis, how do you think that we can leverage these differences or understanding of different generations so that we can better learn from other people, collaborate and innovate, so have a more harmonious intergenerational kind of landscape rather than one that's more centered on division or conflict? Because I think it is, and it's the media, they like the headlines that poke fun at different generations and create animosity between them. The intergenerational conflict can be ripe at times, can be sarcastic at times, can be unhelpful. But how do you think we can move towards a place where these insights help us to actually collaborate and have empathy with people who are different to us?
I think we need to take responsibility for changing the narrative and changing the conversation, and that's everybody. Yes, the media has a large platform and of influence, but it can only go so far, because we change how we interact with our friends, how we interact with our families, how we interact with our workplaces. The media can have an influence, but it doesn't actually make a decision for us. We, at the end of the day, make that decision. And so I think we all need to take responsibility for actually looking at how we speak and how we interact with the generations and going, am I actually unintentionally saying things that are just rude? Or am I saying things that actually honour someone's experience that went before me? And, you know, I think of a time where it was back when I was working in a high school, and I had a much older leader than me. She would be a builder and Gen Y, but, you know, very early stage of my career. And we'd done some fundraising, and she really wanted to present a check to somebody and make a big deal out of it and get a photo, you know, with the handshake and the organization. And I'm just dying inside. I'm like, let's just give the money, move on. They can do everything. And I really had to stop and go, you know what? Let me just pause and think about how things were celebrated as she was growing up in the time that she's been in, and recognize this is actually a way that she honors what people have done. Do I agree with it? No, not necessarily. Is it actually going to hurt me to go along with it? No, not at all. So great. Why don't I just do that? And so I think we actually need to analyze ourselves and our own behavior and see where we're making mountains out of molehills. Like, where are we making this much bigger than it needs to be? And I think generational analysis can help us start to have that level of understanding of where someone is coming from. It can give them insight into why they might hold a particular perspective and maybe some of the factors that have actually contributed to that perspective, which can then, as you said earlier, lead to empathy. And I think we need to actually recognize that if someone holds a different perspective, that actually doesn't invalidate or devalue our own perspective. Because if we think that, that can put us on the defensive, and that's where we actually get that challenge and that sense of conflict. If, however, we can go, okay, that's your perspective based on all of your life experience. This is my perspective based on all of my life experience. Let's share those and actually learn from each other. Because often when you learn why someone's held a perspective, my goodness, sometimes you're like, oh, okay, yeah, if I had gone through that, I would hold that same perspective. Mm-hmm. And I think the more that we can listen, it comes back to stories. The more that we can listen to other people's stories, the more that we can hear their thinking behind statements, and then put ourselves in their own position and go, if I went through that, how might I have responded? We'll never know, but how, like, that self-reflection moment, because if we can learn from others rather than shut them down, then we've got an opportunity to actually build something much more harmonious and much more cohesive. And I think that's the power of generations. Like, we don't have to learn everything out by ourselves. We don't have to make every mistake on our own. We can actually learn from those that have gone before us if we choose to ask the question. And those that are older can learn from those that are younger. They can learn about, okay, why is this of something that's so much value? Or how much has the context changed that this has needed to become a topic of conversation? So there's so much opportunity if we can actually just lay down our ability to get offended for a moment and approach the conversation with empathy. And I think that can go a really long way.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think, like you said, stories are such a great antidote to like a lack of understanding. You put yourself in someone else's shoes, you consider what you might have done, like you said, you increase in empathy and understanding. And even if you don't agree with their stance on something, lay down your ability to be offended. I think that's a great statement, something really helpful for us to take into lots of different areas of life and work, and the ability to debate ideas in a healthy way and appreciate difference, you know, is only going to become more important as our communities become more diverse generationally, culturally, gender. There's so many different ways that can, I think, translate. And yeah, even what you said at the start of that answer, I was thinking about how refreshing it is when you speak to someone who is of an older generation who is like, oh, I love working with young people. They bring fresh ideas. And like, it's so refreshing to have people who appreciate the difference. And that does not to say that they don't acknowledge the challenges that come with every person, an individual and collective of people, but to have that and to speak like that, I think, is a great way that someone who is a leader can influence their environment. So amazing insights. So thank you so much for coming on this journey with me today. I remember pitching this idea to you and I'm like, I know that you can handle the pros and the cons. And I think that's the amazing platform this podcast does allow us, is to kind of chat through some of these areas that we often talk about in our work. And like anything has pros and cons, and it should be stated for the record, we definitely believe in generational analysis. We back it. There are lots of pros, but also just to talk about the limitations and to, I guess, address some of those questions we do get asked quite frequently about the limitations that it might provide. So thank you so much, Soph. Appreciate your time and expertise.
Pleasure. Love the chat.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast, give us a follow on social media, or simply head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.